the heraldic fanfare for Warner Brothers Pictures, written by Max Steiner in 1938, and then used to introduce almost all Warner films over the next 20 years. Its rich crescendo is an affectionate reminder of the golden age of Hollywood pictures, when its busy composer invented unfailingly beautiful and dramatic music to underscore films that would have been far less attractive had he not been associated with them. Max Steiner is the dean of Hollywood composers, the warmly regarded granddaddy of picture scoring. His three Oscar-winning scores are The Informer, Since You Went Away, and Now Voyager. Many others were nominated, many others won awards and prizes from other sources. His magnum opus, Gone with the Wind, failed to win the Oscar in 1939, but it has since become the best-loved score ever written. Steiner has contributed his music to more than 200 pictures over the past 30 years. Most of his best scores were written for Warner Brothers. He joined that studio in 1937, and his first score there was for the spectacular historical adventure picture starring Errol Flynn at the start of his dynamic career, The Charge of the Light Brigade. Max Steiner was born in Vienna on May 10, 1888. He grew up in a musical and theatrical environment. Steiner left Vienna in 1908 and went to London, 6 years later to New York, all the while working as an arranger and conductor for various musical theaters. He arrived in Hollywood at the end of 1929 and immediately began work arranging and conducting music for films. More than anyone else, it was Steiner who paved the way for original dramatic music in movies. He realized the need and saw the opportunity for a new kind of composition. In 1933, Steiner scored a picture that remains a classic of fantasy, King Kong. Max Steiner's music for King Kong. Now here's where it is in Beverly Hills, reminiscing about that picture.
It was a picture that was made for music. Just like The Informer was. That's the reason it won. I mean, it was built for music. And King Kong, of course, you had a great chance to really do anything you wanted to, from dissonances to nice melodies, so forth. And I don't say put it on a map. I think the picture that put music on the map, if I talk about myself, which I don't like to do so much, was a thing called Symphony 6 Million, years and years ago.
That was 1934, wasn't it?
Yes, I was a baby in arms in those days. And David Selznick, who was then my boss there, saw the picture and says, "Max, do you think you could put some music behind this thing? You think that might help it?" And I said, "Yes, I think so." He says, "Well, I'll tell you what, let's try it. Do one reel and show me what you can do, what you think should be done, and then if you don't feel like you want to do it, we'll get somebody else to do it. But try it and see what you can get." Because in those days, we did not use any music as underscoring. Unless you saw the source, unless there was an orchestra, portrayed on the screen, or a piano, or a harpsichord, or an organ, or what have you, people said, you can't use music, because people will say, where's the music coming from? This was the first underscoring done. When I wrote that reel where Gregory Ratliff dies, the father, and we recorded it, and Sosnick looked at it, and Frank Newman, who was a theater owner in Seattle, and they went out of their mind. He says, my God, he says, what you've done with this thing is just wonderful. Why don't you write the rest of the picture? He says, I thought you were going to get somebody else. And they said, no, we don't want anybody else, just you. And I scored it, and as you know, it was quite a success. And it proved that underscoring helps the action sometimes. Well, there can be, of course, wrong underscoring. And that'll help you if that happens.
Music in the wrong places.
Yeah. I mean, the spotting of music, you're leading to something, Tony. The hardest thing for a motion picture scorer is to know where to start, where to stop, where to the location of your music, that you don't play the wrong scenes, then of course comes the wrong type of music. Music can slow up an action, but should not be slowed up. Music can also speed up an action, but it should be speeded up. To know when you do that, that makes a good picture scorer. And I've always tried to submerge myself, I can't find the word now. You don't know the word either, Tony.
No.
I mean...
To subordinate.
Subordinate, that's it. Myself to the picture. See, a lot of picture scorers make a big mistake. They think that this is a concert platform in which they show off what they can do. The minute a man does that, a composer, he's a dead duck, because this is not the place. That is on the concert platform. In a motion picture, the music should be heard but not seen. Well, I don't know. You know, the old story was in the days when I first started, everybody said a good picture score is that you don't notice. And I've always said, what good is it if you don't notice it? I mean, that's silly. But what they didn't understand was that the music could be so bad that it distracts and takes away from your action or from your story. Of course it is wrong. Therefore, I have noticed some scores where a very good composer, we have some very good composers in this business. They show what they know about counterpoint. They want to show construction. The guy will take a melody and then record it as is, and then they figure out what to do now. Then they put violin solos over it, and transfigurations, and trapments, or whatever you call them, and decorate this thing. And it's hard enough to understand a melody behind dialogue, much less with all this baloney going on over it. That's not for the screen. That's why some of these composers that we have now lose out. It gets too decorative. It gets too complicated. By the time you get through, all you hear is the counterpoint, and you lose your melody, and by this time you lose your appeal for emotions, or whatever it is. The general belief is that a motion picture composer, especially in Hollywood, is a man that comes out and sits down at the piano and writes a score. That is not true. Those who have been successful in our business as students and men that have studied all their lives. For instance, I am a graduate of the Imperial Academy of Music of Vienna. I'm a winner of the Emperor's Medal. I studied with some of the greatest professors that ever existed, like Gustav Mahler, Hermann Grevener, Felix Weingarten, Brenner, and I did, there's a course of 7 years there. I did the 7 years in 1 year and won the gold medal.
Max Steiner was to win more than an academic gold medal as the years progressed. But apart from his awards, he has the admiration of multitudes of people in every part of the world. Being Viennese by birth, Steiner has a talent for waltzes. My own favorite Steiner waltz occurs in the 1938 Betty Davis picture, Jezebel. Now the composer at home, recalling his birthplace, Vienna.
It was the cradle of the operettas, you know, like Merry Widow, and in those days, Wallstream, even the Gilbert and Sullivan shows, Mikado, Pirates of Penzance, and Offenbach, Orpheus and the Underworld, and my father produced most of these things. My grandfather produced the Johann Strauss things. The Night in Venice and Fledermausse, Bat, as it's called here.
Did they manage
my
the...
My grandfather found Johann Strauss. He was playing violin at Reisenweber's in Schönbrunn near the castle. And he brought him, he took him to Vienna, made him start writing for the theater. Up to that time, he had written a lot of waltzes and so forth. But my grandfather, Maximilian Steiner, by the way, the same name as mine. I show you the theater right here. It's right, hanging right on my wall. It's a piece of board out of my grandfather's bedroom where he died that they made up and framed it. And so forth.
So you were born into this musical environment.
I conducted an American operetta called The Belle of New York, which was by Gustav Kircher when I was 12 years old.
You conducted professionally?
I conducted. No, with my father's theater. And when Kircher came to New York, he met me and he said, I was still going to school. He says, Max, this is better than I did in New York. He says, why don't you give up and come as a boy wonder? And my mother put her foot down. He says, all musicians and waiters are stinkers.
Your mother said that?
Yeah, my mother had three restaurants. She was a wonderful, she was supposed to be the most beautiful woman of Vienna. But she was. She was, and my father married her. She was in the chorus in my grandfather's theater, and Papa fell in love with her. And that's why I'm here, annoying the audiences in Hollywood. And he wanted me to come with him. And then Sousa came to New York, to Vienna. And we were so impressed with him that I went out of my mind. With this big brass band, he had about 65 men with him, in his lousy uniforms, his black uniforms, with his horrible caps. But concert, I'll never forget. He played a few marches of his. Nothing happened. The audience sat there, applauded very politely. And then he played the Blue Danube. And such a performance you've never heard. I thought the Viennese went out of their minds.
John Philip Sousa playing Viennese music in Vienna?
Oh, boy. And how? And it was so wonderful. I never forget. The Blue Danube. And you know, the Viennese know how to play waltz, and so did Sousa. Believe it or not, with all his marches. Well, Dave went out of his, just absolutely nuts. I think he played it four times. Said, hold on, waltz, it takes 10 minutes. That was the end of the concert. And of course, everybody loved him. And he too, the reason I'm talking about it is, he too came to me, and Father, he said, he saw me conduct, it was at the same time. And he says, why don't you let me take Max home to America and see what we can do there? And my father says, no, he's going to finish school. A good job it is, too.
Is it true that you wrote an operetta when you were 14?
Yes. No, I was 15.
Was it called Beautiful Greek Girl?
Beautiful Greek Girl, yes. And we had, my father, there's quite a story to this. My father had a stage manager by the name of Carl Tuschel. T-U-S-C-H-L. And Tuschel left him and leased a theater called the Orpheum in the Josefstadt. My father then owned the theater in the Wien. He had Venice and Vienna, a very big park, something like Disneyland, only not, of course, that big. He built that giant Ferris wheel that you see
in the Prater in Vienna.
Yes, yeah, my father built that. Yeah, and I wrote. Papa was awfully mad at Tuschel, Carl Tuschel, because he left him. See, and when I wrote this show, I wrote the music and I wrote the script, but I didn't finish the script myself because I couldn't do that. I mean, but a man by the name of Julius Wilhelm finally finished the script. And we took it to my daddy when we finished it. And Papa says it stank. It was no good. He didn't have any part of it. So I said, why don't we go over to Tuschel and see what happens? We took it to Tuschel. Tuschel took it, produced it. I conducted the opening night. The show was dirty. It was really dirty. A very pornographic sort of a thing. And it ran a year. And that's how I got my first motor car and my first motorcycle.
A 15-year-old boy.
15-year-old boy, and I've got the music to prove it.
Max, how did you get to Hollywood?
On the train.
Well, I mean, what brought all this about?
Well,
why?
I was doing a show. Oh, I did a lot of shows, and I worked for everybody, Gershwin, Kern, Herbert and everybody, to orchestrating. And I did a show called Sons of Guns, which was produced by Connolly and Swanson. And William LeBaron, who was then the president of RKO, came just to the opening, Imperial Theater in New York. And I had an orchestra of 35 men, and every one of my men played about 5 different instruments. And we had, at one time, we had 30 violins, then we had 20 trumpets. I did all the orchestrations and everything. And he was out of his mind. And when the show was over, he came down to the pit. I was playing the exit march. And he says, Max, will you come and see me tomorrow at 4 o'clock in the RKO building? And I said, yes, I will. And I went, and he says, you've got to come to Hollywood. He says, I've never had such a performance in my life. And I said, all right. What's in it? He told me. 2 weeks later, I came to Hollywood.
When was that?
This was in 1929, Christmas.
How long did it take you to write Gone with the Wind? That's more than 3 hours of music.
It's about 3 months. 3 months, but in between I did a picture called Intermezzo.
You were working on other pictures?
During Gone with the Wind, yeah. That old symphony with her at the same time. It took me about 3 months.
Did you enjoy writing for Gone with the Wind?
Yes, I loved it. I thought it was one of the greatest pictures I ever saw.
That's your kind
yes,
of story.
Yes, I can. That was my kind of story. Besides, I was red hot for Vivian Leigh, so, so in those days I was young enough to be that way. Now I don't care. Even Phyllis Diller doesn't interest me anymore.
But Gone with the Wind is full of a historical romance that has passion and emotion and culture. Color.
I think it's still one of the best, greatest things. I'll tell you another picture where my poor David... I loved him. David Sosnick didn't get enough credit. I thought Since You Went Away was a charming picture. That was a wonderful picture. I won the Academy, by the way.
I know. You must have believed in the picture because you wrote beautiful music
for
it.
It's a peculiar thing, Tony. On Gone with the Wind, everybody won an Academy Award except me. I was the only one that didn't win. And in Since You Away, nobody won. I was the only one who won with music. So it got even, you know?
Yet of all your scores, it's possible that Gone with the Wind is the best loved, best remembered.
Yeah, well, sure, that's... well, that's... the picture helps the score, don't you know, Tony? That you could have the greatest music that ever was written. You could have Richard Wagner, I don't care who. And if the picture stinks, may I say that, the score will fall down. A music will help a picture. It can never save it. That is a, that they keep on saying the music, no music ever saves a picture. Music saves a picture in the case of Fair Lady. My Fair Lady, but this is, that music is, was a hit before My Fair Lady. I mean, long before that. And it was beautifully done, and I'm not blogging Warner's, but I think it's one of the best pictures I ever saw in my life. But on a regular dramatic picture. You could never save a picture.